Okay, now on to tonight's program. Dar Williams is a folk singer-songwriter whose tours have taken her to the heart of America's small towns. She has released 9 albums with millions of copies sold, including In the Time of Gods and her latest, Emerald. She leads a songwriting retreat at the Garrison Institute and teaches a course entitled Music Movements in a Capitalist Democracy at Wesleyan University. Well, I want to take that class so bad. And as I said, joining her tonight is Senator Rebecca Saldaña, the Democratic representative in the Washington State Senate's 37th District since December 2016. Formerly the executive director of Puget Sound Sage. She has a long history of community involvement, has worked with the Alliance for Clean Jobs and Energy and the Latino Community Fund of Washington, as well as union organizing with SEIU Local 6 and PACUN. Senator Saldaña is on the Senate Democratic Leadership Team, as well as the Transportation Committee and the Commerce, Labor, and Sports Committee. Please join me in giving a warm round of applause to Dar Williams.
When I went to your town on the wide open shore, oh, I must confess I was drawn to the ocean. I thought it spoke to me. He said, look at us, we're not churches, not schools, not skating ponds, swimming pools. Now we have lost people, haven't we though? That's what the ocean can know of a body. And that's when I came back to town. This town is a song about you. I have to clear my throat. Excuse me.
That was gross. By the way, this is a song that was inspired by the Pacific Northwest. That's why I'm singing it, because I came up here and for the first time and this one. And it's kind of sinister, but it's still, you know. Love. All right.
You don't know how lucky you are. You don't know how much I adore you. You are a welcoming back from the ocean. I went back to the ocean today. With my books and my papers, I went to the rocks by the ocean. But the weather changed quickly. Oh, the ocean said, what are you trying to find? I don't care, I'm not kind. I have bludgeoned your sailors. I've spat out their keepsakes. Oh, it's ashes to ashes, but always the ocean. But the ocean can't come to this town. This town is a song about you. You don't know how lucky you are. You don't know how much I adore you. You are a welcoming back from the ocean. La 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 la. That can know you so well are the ones that can swallow you whole. I have a good and I have an evil. I thought the ocean thought me. I didn't go back today. I wanted to show you that I was more land than water. I went to pick flowers. I brought them to you. Look at me, look at them with their salt up the stem. But you frowned when I smiled and I tried to arrange them. You said let me tell you the song of this town. You said everything closes at 5. After that, well, you just got the bars. You don't know how precious you are. Walking around with your little shoes dangling. I am the one who lives with the ocean. It's where we came from, you know. And sometimes I just wanna go back. After a day, we drink till we're drowning. Walk to the ocean, waiting with our work boots. Wait in our work boots, try to finish the job. You don't know how precious you are. I am the one who lives with the ocean. You don't know how. I am the one. You don't know how. I am the one.
So this is very exciting, it's true. It is a marriage of music and wonkiness, and nothing has made me happier. and I did a practice show about a week ago and learned a lot of things, like I should probably tell you what it is that I wrote. What happened was that I came up with this kind of theory called positive proximity. And it's this thing that I sort of discovered because I was so curious about what was happening in the United States. In 1995, I was out on the road with my manager boyfriend, Charlie, and we were going through all of these shuttered down downtowns of Ohio and Indiana. And he said, this is the future. We won't have downtowns because there's this thing called the big box. And I said, what's a big box? So that's where we were in 1995. We didn't really see it coming. But what we did see, I wrote a song called Bought and Sold, and it's very depressing. But you know, it's there you'll find the rust and debtors, motel signs with missing letters. That's what we were seeing. And then suddenly I saw towns that were creating reasons to come back to their greens. And I saw it in Keene, New Hampshire, with a town hall type, with the old opera house, in fact, that they're renovating. And you know, a lot of people did these renovations, and the very last thing they figured out was how to heat the dressing room. But that's okay. So they were very not only excited about that, but they were talking about landscaping projects and new businesses coming, and very modest little things, but they were adding up, and they knew it. And so I started to study in my mind what was helping people come back to their town centers, and that just kept on accelerating, and then it became a thing. So I'm going to read the thing moment for you, to give you a sense of what happened. So positive proximity, I was discovering positive proximity, which is a state of being where living side by side with other people is experienced as beneficial. I had been seeing this phenomenon of town building for more than 20 years. Someone starts something, others join in, and then everything starts to shift into more clarity, more resilience, more goodwill, and more pride. Libraries find their way into the digital age. Schools improve. People actually sit and eat ice cream on the benches eerily empty for years. I've seen the power of positive proximity firsthand in hundreds of towns, such as Lowell, Massachusetts, hit with the twin degradations of industrial downturns and a crack epidemic in the 1990s. I saw it in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, where, after the R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company left the state in 1995, the promoters of my near-empty concert were vowing that they would revive the city through the arts. Good luck with that, I thought. They did have very good luck with that. I didn't understand the power of positive proximity that I had witnessed until I was having dinner at my friend Kate's house in Virginia. Her husband, Hal Movius, who writes books about conflict resolution, filled my wine glass and asked, "What do you think determines the relationships we'll have in our towns?" Hal loves to pore through Harvard studies and explain them to dinner guests. I said, "Values? No. Politics? No again. Hobbies? Wrong." Hal said, "Proximity, that's all." I disagreed. Into my mind came full-blown images provided by news headlines of neighbors fighting over parking spaces and fallen tree branches. I'd just heard the story of a company that could identify DNA in dog poop so people could know the genetic fingerprint, as it were, of the anonymous offenses in their courtyards. Early clients were co-op associations. But then I realized with a jolt, the study Hal was referring to was right. When people transcend the myth that proximity means conflict and invasion of privacy, they gravitate toward finding ways to integrate the talents and skills of their community members. Not only that, after people discover each other in the commons of town, more connections are made. And the next thing you know, you're Lowell, Massachusetts, that small city that had a terrible drug problem, but now has 5 museums, a popular minor league stadium and team, and a free concert series that attracts thousands of families every summer. So that's where I'll leave it. We'll leave it at that. We'll leave it at that. But this is a wonderful thing I saw. Actually, I'll read the other section now, because I would love to get to talking to Rebecca sooner than later. I created these categories of what I saw people doing. One category was spaces. There are certain spaces that are conducive to people having certain kinds of conversations that turn outward and inward to community, depending how you position community. And other people, and then after you have these spaces or in coexisting with that, I found that people who find projects that build the identity of their town do well. So when they say, "We just wanna be cool, you know, we just wanna be civil, we just wanna," that doesn't really, then everybody gets into conflicts over those abstractions. But when people say, you know, "Let's create this beautiful space here." I mean, this is a wonderful community space and has a beautiful sign out there and it's got a beautiful feeling. And there was probably a decision about what was gonna be done downstairs and upstairs and the seats. These kinds of projects create certain kinds of relationships across lines and create something called, Robert Putnam, who wrote Bowling Alone, calls bridging social capital. And bridging social capital means that you get out of these wonderful bonds that you have, let's say, in your church or in your clubs, and you bridge over to people who belong to different other clubs and different other, you know, bonding associations, and then you really start to cook. So one of the things that I found was a great identity builder was and also a great space was how people use the outdoors, and in this case, I just thought I would go right to Seattle, how the indoors and outdoors are sort of integrated into an identity of space that builds what I consider to be positive proximity because it creates a common sense of identity. So we were in Moab. So we leave Moab and go up the Cascade Trail through mossy rainforests and into Seattle, where we can look at the way a city has incorporated nature into its urban identity. Many other cities have done the same. None has done it better. When I asked my friend Bellamy Palethorpe to meet me at Ben Arroyo Hall in 2013, she said, "Meet me under the Chihuly." "The what?" I had to meet a reporter later that day. He also said, "I'm just downstairs from the Chihuly." It was a given that I'd know the Chihuly, a 10-foot-long hourglass-shaped chandelier of hand-blown glass that's teeming with white and beige serpentine cylinders spilling through a tower of ornate glass spheres. Technically, Dale Chihuly's sculptures are cultural icons in Seattle, not natural ones, but I recognize his work and that of many glass and textile artists in Seattle as emblematic of its natural identity. The chandeliers at Ben Arroyo Hall, despite their name, Crystal Cascade, suggest a parallel world of marine life that exists in the bordering Puget Sound. Like much of Chihuly's work, the Crystal Cascade chandeliers have glass that flows outward and upward as if it is underwater. There is a modern aquatic elegance in his pieces that underscores Seattle's identity as a city on a body of water, reminding us that beyond the wide paved plazas and cement staircases at the Puget's shores, There are undulating seagrasses, kelp, octopi, and anemones. Seattle is famous for Microsoft, tech millionaires, and a gadget-savvy populace. Is that cool with you? Okay. It is also home to a ferociously independent music scene that began in the 1980s through the 1990s, not just the presenting stage of Nirvana and Pearl Jam, but also of the media skeptical and extremely innovative riot girl bands such as Sleater-Kinney, L7, and Bikini Kill. But the sense of the sea is everywhere in its public spaces, inside and out, especially thanks to the monumental biomorphic pieces by Puget Sound glassblowers and weavers who have staked out a unique artisanal identity for their region. Seattle has a culture that's set within a very specific and dynamic landscape, and it's all woven together. On a big loom, the warp consists of vertical strings through which the weft, the horizontal strings, are woven. In Seattle, there's a metaphoric electronic warp of smartphones, piercings, overdriven amps, and architecture like the silver cacophonic, that's my own word, Frank Gehry designed Experience Music Project. But this highly charged warp is woven through an even deeper weft of Dungeness crab legs in the markets, educational signs with depictions of limpets and eelgrass, and the constant misty sheets of salty air. Where deep grunge and sci-fi tech ideas could turn into a dystopic isolation, Seattle is instead deeply sensitive to its identity as an ecosystem to be protected and respected. Seattle is filled with indoor spaces advantageous to building positive proximity, but it is the mix of the outdoors and the indoors that makes every conversation a little more unique, with a bit more sense of shared place. Strong, emblematic, natural representation gives Seattle a feel, a palette, neutral browns, greens, blues, and a dash of neon orange starfish, and a dialectic counter to all the wires and conduits in one of this country's most dynamic urban centers. So. So that's, it was a very interesting tiger to grab by the tail, this thing that I saw in 1,000 towns. And I really had a great time going through each of them and finding things. And there are a lot of other things that I found that Seattle does very well. And there's something, the third category besides identity building is what I call translation. And that was particularly elusive, but translation means, what do your signs look like? Are they clear? Do they tell you where to go? And the answer is yes. Seattle, as a person coming from the outside, to me, is what I call a town that has, a city that has a hometown pride and a worldly welcome. There's a strong sense of identity, but there's also a sense that I'm really welcome to be here. As a performer and as a tourist and as an outsider, there's a way that I am led around by signs and by the ethos in the air, which is very hard to define, but it's there. There's a way that you know, we think that having a strong sense of space can make us xenophobic, but I have found the opposite, which is that actually when you have a strong sense of place, you want to share it. And there's a lot of ways that Seattle has rolled out the carpet for the world to come in, because there's a confidence here. And that can be a kind of a reinforcing. The more thing you welcome in the world, the more, the bigger and more sophisticated your world becomes. The more sophisticated it becomes, the prouder you are, and the more you want to share it with the world. So that's positive proximity as well. And that was harder for me to try to pin down in the third category of the book. But those were some of the, I was looking for certain kinds of relationships and ways that the city translates itself that I found to be, you know, conducive to building that sense of civic engagement and an understanding that we are our own government and we are our own culture makers and we are the people who can benefit personally as well as, you know, benefiting our communities. We benefit personally from being a part of something. I called this book a self-help book to somebody at the publishers, and they said, no, we're not going to call it that. But I, but just like we are told to write in our journals and look inside to who we are, I consider a lot of our identity to be potentially in our cities and towns and how we put ourselves into it without feeling invaded by it, but feeling like we belong and are valuable to it. So I wrote this next song again. I think I've written a lot of songs that have to do with this area. In this case, the area is broadly defined because this was written along I-84. This is called Emerald. And so I widen the identity of the Emerald City to this whole region because it just, you know, one of the other reasons I wrote this book is that, you know, that sense of regional identity and people who know to, shall we say, capitalize on it, but in a very beautiful, not non-financial way in a lot of cases, I thought had something, you know, they were happier for understanding the treasures that they had in their backyard, and I certainly sensed that with the people in Portland and Seattle. So again, this is called Emerald, and after this, we will sit down, Rebecca and I, and talk together. Here we go.
I have come to the west, the Emerald Kingdom highway. It's like a hero's path I'm following. I don't know what to think, what to do with myself today. Shouldn't I hear the future calling me? Under a low cloud, vanishing up through the tree line of the mountain, catching the light from the morning on a river come to life, the Grand Columbia. I've returned this time to these cascades in autumn, and for once I am unquestioning. I can see the boatmen shout over the wind and engines as the gold coins shower from aspen trees. And into the twilight, a hazy moon on the amethystine river, watching the heron lifting up and her wings spread wide as the Columbia. To my pride, I had filled my memories with these hours of gold and emerald light. I can plunge my hands into all this time I've lived, and the jewels spill through my fingers. I have come to the west, to this canyon highway. I can see a girl is passing. She is going so fast I can hardly tell it's me. Doesn't she know that she'll be traveling? Under a low cloud, out of the northwest into the Rocky Mountains, across the prairies to the Appalachian rises, now the Pennsylvania farms, into the traffic of the eastern cities, into my town, onto my street, up the stairs, into my house, grab the kids and out the back, into the garden.
Thank you. I have a little transition here. This is Amanda. And you know what, Patty, can I ask you to deal with so that would be, yeah, if you can hold it out there. Rebecca might want to do a song. I don't know. So
maybe home.
I did sing in choir, but it's been a while.
Choirs are great.
Well, thank you so much for coming to Seattle. And as we were talking just a little bit beforehand, I was coming of age in the 90s as a student at Seattle University and had a chance to get acquainted with Dar's music. In accepting this opportunity to come and interview a singer-songwriter that I've admired for a really long time, had a chance to connect with some of my friends. I see some of them in the room. And we were just talking about, you know, I think one of the things that I found that you gave to a lot of us was just voice and song to compel and a lot of us to think outside the box, actually. I think a lot of us that were feeling that we didn't conform, questioning our boxes, and a lot of friends in this area that are gender benders, you gave us a place to really kind of explore that in a safe way and to help us find that we actually did belong. And I think that gave us a lot of power in our place. So I just want to, first of all, thank you
for
writing When I Was a Boy.
Thank you. Thank you.
So as someone that is a singer-songwriter and a professor, I just want to maybe start out with, like, what compelled you to write this book?
Well, after that dinner party, I was thinking about this thing, and I was looking at my town. My town has a lot of, it's just outside of New York City, but there are some people who are proud that they'd never been to New York City, like that was a mark of pride for them. And so, you know, there were these kind of worlds, and some bad stuff had gone down in our town historically, and people knew about that, and yet all these people were coming, and a lot of them artisans, people who would just go into New York City once a week, as opposed to, you know, just the commuting thing. So there were some really great thinkers, and I was watching the way we were able to find common ground, and like, we have these tomatoes, these you know, we grow all these different tomatoes, and we're on a corner in the village, and all of these old Italian guys from our town, they were like, so how's that going? You know, why did you grow the San Marzanos? Because they only grow in San Marzano. And, you know, in Italy, like, why did you even try? You know, and we have very different politics from them, and we're in a very different demographic and in a lot of ways. But I loved that common ground that we had with them. And so I was watching that. And then I talked about it in an interview, and in the interview I said, someone should write a book about this thing that I call positive proximity, because there is negative. You can turn proximity into a negative force, but people who kind of consciously, unconsciously choose to make it positive, and one's like, okay, tell me more. And so that became the interview, and then I got a phone call from Sarah Lawrence College, and they said, can you do a concert and talk about this thing that you're calling positive proximity? And what was really nice, and I don't know if this is going to happen here, you probably already sort of know this about yourself in a city like Seattle, but people really wanted to talk about their towns. They really understood. It was personal for them. And it was also nice for them to have an opportunity to sort of see their towns poetically, not just what's going wrong, what's going right, what project, or the fights that we're having. So I loved what I saw, and I realized that a lot of my songs had a lot to do with how we locate ourselves, either in here or, but really in that interface between here and out here. And then I started to think, maybe I will write that book. And I started to take notes and form these categories, and then I talked to my mom and I said, Mom, all right, I've been talking about this thing. Is it a thing? She said, it's a thing. So then I approached publishers and said, I think this is a thing. And they said, we agree.
So what was the process? I mean, how did it differ from songwriting? How were you able to bring creativity into this process?
It was hard. As I wrote, I was like, oh gosh, songwriting is so much easier than this. And now I'm back to songwriting. I'm like, oh, writing the book was so much easier than this. So you know, you're either way, you're creating something out of thin air. You know, we just all have to pat ourselves. I mean, even how we navigate a day is creating something out of thin air. So it's just, you know, really hoping that you find the most invigorated way, the best language possible to say what you know you want to say, because there was a kind of, there was a way of kind of putting it out there, but with songs, you know that a word that can kind of pop and a word that can kind of keep the attention and have, you know, the colors, like the colors you see around, you know, you have these beautiful palettes all of color all around Seattle, and the way that certain colors pop and yet stay very true to the identity of this you know, Puget Sound city, you want your writing to do the same thing. It was a big challenge.
So one thing that I talked about that you helped us think outside the box, but one thing that I found interesting in your theory is that you speak about this group of folks that are conscious bridgers, and that actually something you saw in them was this idea of their ability to work inside boxes. So I just wondered if you wanted to share a little bit about either a person or an example of where you saw that really working.
You know, the person that was the best example of thinking inside the box is a guy who works with a lot of, he's basically a neurologist. He does a lot of work with veterans, and he understands, but he also loves music. And so when he saw that there was an arts and medicine program, he got himself involved, because for him, it's always finding the next bridge to bridge personalities. He works with a concert series that bridges the accounting, which is an instrument from Africa, with the banjo, and creating the relationship between the two continents of how these instruments have the same origins. And there are these ways. So he loves African music. He loves the banjo community in the United States. He loves these veterans that he works with, and he cares about them. But his joy is taking all those things he knows and creating bridges. And one of the most common things I found with these people I call conscious bridgers is a lot of them, somewhere would have the beginning of a sentence, "I don't read as much as I should, ... because they are reading us. They are reading their environments and saying, oh, if the, you know, he had a research assistant who was apparently great. He loved this young woman. But there was a job coming up in New York, and he heard about it, and he said, she should apply for this job. So he basically lost his best assistant because he saw that bridge to her future, and he couldn't resist, and he told her to do it, and she got the job, and it changed her life. So this is, these are people, they read. They read things very clearly. They see the box. They don't disrespect the box. But they get in there, and I say they just get in there and move stuff around in the box. The people who think outside the box are also very valuable. And what's really great are the people who kind of jump back and forth. They don't worry about, they're willing to spend time outside the box and then bring that back to the box and say, it's not so bad out there, let's try that. And that's something that we can do for each other, actually, within communities as well. It doesn't have to necessarily be one brave person jumping outside. We can evolve towards new ways of thinking.
Yeah, definitely. Well, I mean, so I encourage people to read this book.
Thank you.
I got an early copy. And I mean, I do think that another piece that you mention on page 239, in case you want to look, is this idea of measuring the strength of positive proximity by things that communities do that bring power and life to the commons, even when they're hard to organize and sustain. And so when I read that piece, I thought a lot about our community in the 37th. So we are the historically redlined community of Seattle. It's from Central District to unincorporated King County and Renton Skyway. And we are one of the most diverse communities. And just on the way here, my day today, I'm just gonna share you a little bit, included like driving into Columbia City this morning and seeing the church service going on at the Lutheran church, and you know, it's a, you know, a very welcoming, inclusive community. I know there's the members here, and they are working with a local nonprofit to build affordable housing, which is their current, on their current parking lot. And then went to a community political meeting, and then today, as I was coming back here, you know, drove by the Ethiopian Community of Seattle, which is doing some big festival today, playing music, and then of course driving through Columbia City right now, we do a whole series of beat walk, and so Sunday afternoons there's music venues that includes nonprofit group called Totem Star that works with youth in performance pieces and building their self-esteem and their confidence, and of course like all of our local artists. So it felt really very much like your idea of positive proximity very strong as I was getting ready for today. And so, but I do think also the underside is that a lot of times with everything that we try to create, there's a lot of conflict, and a lot of mistrust and distrust because there's so much historic, you know, the systems were built, and even the way that my neighborhood, Rainier Beach, was built was really as a throwaway, right? And so as you look at, as we were looking at our neighborhood plans a few years ago, and you just look at how the grid was built, it was really built for people to drive through quickly, and to see that despite that there's so much community and proximity, but that often the institutions or the systems were set up in a way to make that more challenging. So just as you're talking about maybe an example, whether it's Wilmington or another, that might bring to you this idea of, you know, how some strategies or tactics or how you saw as someone that's traveling, where power and life was brought forward even when it was hard.
Well, there is that moment of interface. So, but it is really worth it. And I guess, you know, a friend of mine told me that in her town in Virginia, somebody had initiated a conversation about race. And it might be apocryphal. I can't imagine that they just kind of did this, like, let's talk about it. Let's just talk about this issue. And they had it in some gymnasium, and everybody just started fighting. It was just a mess. And I said, if it were me, I would have done what Ben and Jerry's did up in Burlington, Vermont, with they found these empty municipal parking lots and they showed movies up on the top tier of the parking lot because it wasn't, you know, used at night, and they would show movies, free movies, and I said I would do something like that, and I would ask the different schools, you know, public schools, PTAs to do milk and cookies, and get a farmer who's a milk sponsor, and then bring in the great equalizer of all, you know, just something that would be popular with all of the different, you know, with black and white in your city, and that is Eddie Murphy. And I would just show Eddie Murphy movies all summer, and have the PTA parents talking to each other and meeting each other, and kids and opportunities for the kids to meet each other. Just sitting together isn't going to do it, but just kind of creating opportunities. You know, maybe Eddie Murphy trivia contest or something like that. And she just laughed, and I was like, I'm totally serious. and then you know, so something. I think that creating opportunity, I mean, what you just said is a beautiful day, you know, and a Lutheran church that bridges into the community and also bridges to other houses of worship, that's a very effective thing. Houses of worship can be very strong, can become very polarized, and in my town there were a lot of churches growing up and a synagogue. There's now an interfaith panel in my town, and they wrote a letter to the zoning board that said, we just want to let you know that we're sure that the reason that the mosque is not being built, that it's being held up, is because of zoning and not any kind of underlying Islamophobia, but just in case, we just want you to know what great neighbors they have been and what an important contribution that the Islamic community has brought to our town. And the first person who signed it was the rabbi, and then the Presbyterian, and then the Episcopalian ministers. So, bridging between congregations, that's called bridging social capital, That I think is a really, so that instead of being one faith, it's the combination of all these kind of ideas and communities looking into the community. That, so think in bridges, basically, is what I say. Create every opportunity to think in bridges, and then create social bridging opportunities for us to meet in the commons, and then out of that fabric to find our voice in policy and government. But that's where I'm coming from. I see the way effective governance and schools come out of the social fabric that I've seen in these towns. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
And actually, I'm just going to look for whoever. You'll let me know.
Because we have maybe 5 more minutes.
Okay, perfect. Because I'm like, I was taking 30 minutes, but I forgot what time it was when I started. something to see. It is interesting. Like, so the nonprofit I worked with before is called Puget Sound Sage, and they are celebrating 10 years. And when they first really came together was around a community saying no to a box store that was coming into what was historically the Vietnamese community business sector and Chinatown International District. And so it was a lot, I think, of what you talk about in terms of positive proximity and bridge builders. So laborers and grocery workers with the neighborhood and the Vietnamese business community and SCIPTA, which is Seattle Chinatown International District PDA, and so many community groups and families that came out and said no to that, but also yes to a vision that they are still looking to help build. So one other place that I just would love for you to talk about is Carbor. Mm-hmm. Am I saying that right?
Carborough.
Personally, like, my husband was born in Chapel Hill. Mm-hmm. And when I heard your music, the first time, I had a lot of friends and connection to that. So it was something that really drew my attention. I definitely want to come and visit. And maybe you want to share just a little bit about the elements that you saw of positive proximity there. Because I think also here, being in this community center, it's about the arts. But very much about like making sure that we're bringing and celebrating all the arts, and there's a lot of artists in this neighborhood, so I'd be good to hear.
It's very, what was great about Carborough, and that I'm trying to just think what could translate here, they have a lot of arts participation. There's a place called Art Center, and they have all these different kinds of classes, and something that I found in general, that kept on coming up in the book is that the way that retired people were kept in the community conversation and actually helped to drive the community conversation was very important, and that was very present, that they had all these after-school programs for all kinds of kids, but there were also really great writing programs and painting programs, and it was just very intergenerational by nature. And then they also have a theater where they bring in all sorts of acts, and they have the Tibetan monks, as Artmenius, who used to run the center, said, the Tibetan monks are going to come in and they're going to make a mandala, and it was very sweet, and then they're going to blow it away like it didn't ever exist, so they were very conscious about bringing in all these parts of the world I really saw on their roster, but they had this strong sense of participation. They have artisans who work, and the artisans come together so that they can really offer a wide range of stuff and maybe bring down the prices a little bit. So what comes out of that sense of participation is that the former mayor, Ellie, was saying to me, there's a great man, did you see him dancing? He's very tall and he wears this sort of beautiful African garb, and he dances in the main green, and somebody got upset and said, we don't want him dancing there, and so he was told that he wasn't allowed to dance there. Well, the citizens just got up in arms, and they wrote letters, and so now he's dancing there again, and then they also found out that he's on parole, and so they all sent letters down to his parole officer to let them know how much they loved him and how much we appreciate his dancing. So now he's dancing, and also he's out of parole, but they hope that they help that process along. And she said, and then also there was there were these food trucks, and they were in this parking lot of these old businesses, and somebody got upset that they were there. And, you know, I think it was related to, you know, I think it was a little, you know, bigoted because these were Mexican owners of the food trucks. And she said, so they shut them down. And she said, well, everybody was so upset that they, you know, they all showed up at the meetings and they wrote letters and they did this and they did this. And we had a food truck ordinance written in a week. And she said, and it was really cheap to do it. And she said, Chapel Hill took a year, and by then everyone was here. So, and I said, what do you think it was? Is it because you have a strong community radio station? Is it because you have a great newspaper? Is it because people do come to town meetings? And she said, the people here know that they own the town. And I thought, and in the book, I said, I see a parallel between feeling like you own the town, paradoxically having a lot of access to the conversation of the town, a lot of diversity in the conversation, and yet a sense of what the town is, what it can hold, and the arts, the inclusion in the arts, that you can dance your way, design your way, sing your way, rhapsodize your way into the conversation. You've been welcome to express yourself in all these other ways. And I see a connection between the welcoming of artistic voices and all those points of access and the sense that you own your town and that it's your voice that determines what the future is. And you are very welcome to be a part of that, which scares the hell out of developers. And that's great because they don't want that fabric. So they tend to work with a community if they want to come in, so you have something that looks more like the community at the end, you know, despite how big that entity from the outside is.
That might be a great place. I'll end with also in terms of, because you talk about on page 215, blight and momentum developers, and I do think that is exactly the type of thing that then propels is if our community feels like we own our community and have a way and a say to shape that. But the other piece that I liked about the Conscious Bridgers, and maybe this will help open up for audience to consider coming up to one of these two microphones to ask a question or to help stimulate our conversation further, but that the secret in organizing is, the secret is organizing around your interests and creating things that you want for your community. And I think that is something that I would like to hear from the audience of what is it that is your interest in creating for our community. And I think that is something that then does stimulate the positive proximity that Dar Williams speaks of. So
yes, what do you love about where you are and what do you want to see? And where do you see yourself able to participate in that? You know, that's what's so exciting. And I just have to say also that what's nice is that I observed how people build what I call their positive proximity or social capital. They call it a high trust, low trust community. I don't know if you listen to Freakonomics. I was like, that's the stuff that I'm taught. Oh, they already had a name. And yes, we build through our self-interests. And a person was like, you'd have to be a black belt in organizing to organize something that's not interesting to you. And I found that to be very powerful. But then there's that kind of next step that you take, where you take either the participation or the ethos of listening to the community and feeling like the community owns the community together, and creating the policy language so that when basically, there is a moment when a neighborhood tips and it becomes attractive. It's a beautiful thing, and who doesn't want in on it? And developers, it's sort of, I mean, capitalism, I should say, it's sort of like a big nose. It just goes, I smell money, and it's beautiful, you know? And it comes, I mean, and usually there is beautiful, you know, somebody's created a beautiful public fountain or a public garden, you know, it's positive proximity smells wonderful. And there are certain developers, you know, that create big things. And they do not care about the fabric, but they know that they can capitalize on it and plop something in. And there is a time when the fabric is not quite strong enough to engage with the outside developer, and yet they are extremely attractive to the outside developer. And that's a dangerous moment, and because then things start to move very fast. And the people who created that community fabric are exhausted. They did such good work, but they don't want to have to be the ones that have to fight that fight as well. Hopefully, by the time somebody comes in and says, I want to create something that takes advantage of your momentum and profit from it, there's enough shared sense of power that everybody can say, as a community, we'd like to engage with you so this looks like us and looks like all these people we care about so much, and we don't want to get any, you know, we don't want people left behind, nor do we want the environment left behind. That's a sweet spot. There's also a sour note of a developer coming in before the community has really had time to really feel how cool it is. and that can be, and then things can get very not feeling organic anymore in the slightest. So yes, now we will.
Okay, yeah, so we have time for maybe 10 or 15 minutes. Please come on down. You can line up at either side with a question, or if you want to share a powerful community story. We don't have that much time, though, so please try and keep it brief or in the form of a question if you're asking a question. Yeah, over there.
Hi. Oh, I forgot we're live streaming. Hello. Is that one on?
It sounds like that microphone isn't working, so why don't you all come over here?
Okay.
Hello. So I'm when you're talking about all these things, I know exactly what you're talking about when you mention that, like, that community spirit, that engagement, that vibrancy. And then I'm trying to, like, draw all the dots together about, you know, the sense of ownership and who gets to have a sense of ownership. And the vibrancy of a small downtown with mom and pop shops versus the big box stores. And we know that what towns look like and how towns have been destroyed through these systems are rooted in neoliberalism and in racism and in lack of access to, you know, financial capital, but social capital and all of that. And so I'm curious if you have incorporated sort of an analysis of these, like, larger trends in what you're seeing, if you can draw the lines between, you know, racism and redlining and gentrification and who can physically be there and then whose voices are heard and who is sort of allowed to participate in that civic engagement. And a sort of offshoot to that question is, when you were describing Seattle, I think that was a really excellent description of, like, mainstream and dominant Seattle culture. But there are many, many, many different communities in Seattle, and I'm guessing by traveling through, you're not able to see or able to access many of those. And so I'm curious about, like, if this civic engagement and this vibrancy and everything is, if what you're seeing is sort of like the top level, the dominant culture, and how that sort of enters into your thought process.
Well, I think that the presentation of the Puget Sound as an ecosystem, and you can tell me if I'm wrong, but in terms of that kind of, as I said, the palette and color, I sense that that extends outside of just, you know, the public market. And I could be wrong, but, you know, a lot of, this is a Pacific Rim city, and I consider a lot of different communities to be represented within that downtown area. And it's true, I think I look at a lot of at how the city kind of, in the broadest strokes, presents itself to the world. Like, we've got a Ferris wheel, we have a Puget Sound, we have these glass blowers, we have these artisans. But, you know, some, I think that identity also spills into a larger sense of Seattle, so that Seattle knows. I mean, Seattle is environmentally sensitive. I always hear PSAs about recycling when I'm listening to the commercial radio stations and things like that. So I consider that to permeate the region. My feeling is that, in talking sort of generically about spaces and projects and translation, that what happens if we pay attention, you know, where I was really starting from was this kind of post-Aquarian thing where when people said, we just want to pay attention to, you know, to creating love, peace, harmony, that kind of fell flat and actually would become preyed upon by commercial interests. You know, oh, you want to love, you don't love, you don't love well enough, you have to buy this in order to have the love. And but that when there were certain kinds of cafes, and you can probably see those as very sort of bourgeois, those cafes, but it doesn't have, someone, a kid said that his convenience store in his town was the place where people talked, and he said, I know what you're talking about. It's in our convenience store, to be honest, but those kind of conversations happen there. The question really for me was, what creates opportunities for certain kinds of bridges to be built? There are people in Middletown, Connecticut, which is a place that I wrote on about, that really went to work in a class, but they went into the town and they were looking at the history of the Native Americans from that area and some of the oral histories. And you know, so their project was to dig deep into certain histories and into finding certain voices that they found had been disenfranchised. So I do believe that there are certain kinds of spaces, projects, and efforts to translation that absolutely become the inclusive, the most inclusive fabric. That it's not me just saying, it's not just me saying, oh, look, you know, look at all those cool fabric arts that they have in downtown. I'm going to find these cool, you know, gifts for my mom for Christmas, although it is a really great place to find gifts for your mom for Christmas. But, you know, it's I consider there to be an engagement in, you know, like I was listening to a public radio station, PS Media is very important, and it's strong here in Seattle. There was a project, they were talking about bringing out the trains, and I wasn't sure if it's oil or coal, trains from Canada through this area, and there was a public meeting about it, and you could just hear how many people felt they had a voice in this, and you could hear that line of people coming up to the microphone with their emphatic defense of the fabric of where they were from. So I consider these feelings of place and identity and interdependency and interweaving in community to be inclusive of everything that you're talking about, even though it sounds like maybe the examples were like, and then they created this beautiful opera house, and now they have operas there, and aren't the operas great? Actually, ideally, if you're gonna have a space like this or an opera house, the best thing you can do is to look into your neighborhood and bring your neighborhood in as much as possible so that the cultural voice is as diverse as you can possibly make it and as intergenerational. So it's, you know, I consider these to be tenets that are universal. The one thing that you talked about though, Rebecca, is, you know, some neighborhoods are disenfranchised and it's harder to find that resonance or to start creating it, especially when just your everyday experience as individuals is so difficult. It's hard to then find each other and the collective power that you're gonna have. And I do wanna acknowledge that as well.
Hi, I'm a professor at Seattle University, so I love the fact that you've read Robert Putnam. But I wanna push you a little bit harder on this idea that when a community comes together and creates something and stimulates its vibrancy, and the capitalist forces come in, and the housing prices go up, the rents go up. I mean, this is something we're experiencing throughout the city of Seattle and even in the suburbs. So the original community members can no longer afford to live in these communities that are now benefiting from sort of the fruits of the labor of people who were originally here. So what's, did you find any solutions in the cities that you visited that helped address this, and how do we prevent sort of our resident populations from getting pushed out and then changing the fabric of the community yet again?
It was everywhere. I mean, everywhere, and anybody I spoke to under the age of 25 was like, oh, I know what you're writing about, gentrification. I'm like, no, I'm writing about the fact that, you know, these towns, you know, there were steel mills that shut down overnight. And these towns were, you know, just filled with, as one guy said, he goes, I don't want to really label myself, but Phoenixville is where I went to get my drugs, you know, like, how did these places come into a local economy with what I call, you know, two-story prosperity? So you have the merchants on one floor and you have the chiropractors on the second floor or the you know, all sorts of businesses on the second floor, and you have local pride and local identity and local businesses, and, you know, there was something that I was seeing. But then there's this tipping point that happens really fast where it's too much too fast, and all the people are so proud of themselves for what they created, and it is a beautiful thing. And then, you know, and I mean, this is a challenge that we have in our local governments. I'm hoping, because people didn't have the solutions. There are things like when somebody builds a new building, 10% of it has to be of a certain, you know, affordable in some ways. In Carrboro, they wanted to make certain, you know, really lovely rows of houses affordable, and students from Chapel Hill came in and said, oh, perfect, I'll go live there. You know, there, every place had its own challenge with why they couldn't control the prices. But if we have affordable housing and an affordable grocery store and an affordable drugstore, you know, you're still going to have, in gentrified neighborhoods, you know, if your kid wants to play soccer, they have to pay $400 for it, you know. But in our town, we've raised the standard of living together, and the parents coach, and it's very cheap to play soccer. You know, the fabric keeps things affordable. So if there's some way to get the affordability, the housing affordability piece together. But the other thing is the attitude. Somebody said was creating a plan for a city and a grant, and they said, you know, this is a very, this part of your town is a food desert. You know, did you know that, right? So these folks are gonna get pushed out. You should put a grocery store in this giant empty place. Put a grocery store there, please. And this guy said, that's not very sexy. And she said, it's very sexy to me to get rid of a food desert, because otherwise you're just going to become a fancy schmancy. And there are places that are very fancy and cool and have wonderful, vibrant downtown communities, and not one drugstore, not one grocery store, and skyrocketing. So there's an attitude shift, but there's policy language that we have to get to so that we recognize that everybody now says, that's not what we are doing this for. Everybody says, we want to keep the people, and we know exactly who they are, and they're the solution finders in so many ways. They're the funnest, most creative, best gold of our community. We don't want to lose them. But they are struggling, and I'm hoping that policy language, and then I think legislation will help, but the ethos will have to be there too, of the fact that part of your pride is that you're not just one socioeconomic, you know, representation.
So, and maybe I'll just add, I mean, obviously in our community, this is very much central to our conversations right now, is how we're growing and how we're going to grow in a way that allows those of all means to be able to stay in place. And I think one example that I'll give of positive proximity in terms of that idea of how it works is Urban Impact. So Urban Impact is a nonprofit, right, that has built a gym in our community. It's a collaboration of two faith communities, and then they built affordable housing in partnership with another nonprofit developer, and they built family-sized units, right? Private developers downtown and other places kept on telling us that there wasn't a market for two- or three-bedroom apartments, and what we would tell them, there wasn't a market for the way that they price their two- and three-bedroom apartments. Because as soon as Urban Impact put it out, and then El Centro on Beacon Hill, you know, everyone was seeing that there was lines, and they had to do lotteries, right, because there was so much demand. And as someone that works, and still does, even though I'm your state senator, still work with Puget Sound Sage, and one of their coalitions, which is the South Communities Organizing for Regional Racial Equity, building a community control vision for our valley. The thing that I hear and meeting with our coalition are, because Urban Impact is building, they're actually, the staff that they're bringing are people that grew up in our neighborhood, that, you know, their parents moved away or they sent them away, and now they're coming back and being able to find a place for themselves. And I think that's the kind of vision that we have with, there's a whole group of projects including the Economic Opportunity Center in Othello, the Rainier Beach Food Innovation District in Seattle, in Rainier Beach. And I think what we, as a city, and reflecting and having this conversation is that we were really good in the 90s of coming up with these neighborhood plans and empowering our neighborhoods to have a say in how we grew. But our city did not have the tools or the resources to be able to partner with those neighborhoods to realize our growth targets or to also realize some of our projects. Right now, as we're thinking about, I think about the strength of each of our neighborhoods, and I do think the Puget Sound and our connection to the outdoors is a big part of every one of our communities that comes here as a refugee, as an immigrant, as a new person, as those of us that grew up here, is something that's really strong for us. What I, again, the barriers that we created in terms of how we built our city, our transportation, which was totally a total driven thing by the oil industry, but also the way that our neighborhoods were built out. We have really strong neighborhoods, but we're still trying to figure out those connections across neighborhoods, whether it's South Seattle to West Seattle. And I do think that is about the way that we get through that is leading with race. And I think making sure that we are actually centering our conversation. And I will say that's the one piece in terms of feedback or thinking about like the next book is, you know, how do we talk about race and talk about that role that racism has played in the formation of our cities and towns. We didn't start this way, but often we do, starting by recognizing the First Nations, the Duwamish, the Suquamish, the Muckleshoot, on the lands of which we stand, and the lands in which this building was built, and our original streetcar was built in this neighborhood, and now our light rail, and that I think that when we talk about policy and legislation as critical, it definitely is, because we put this, we built legislation and policy that created these communities and towns with a racist lens. And so I think in terms of us moving forward, it is, to me, and I think for our city, that that's something that we need to take head on and do it in a way that actually is building bridges.
My name is Hank Davis. I have a suggestion for Dar Williams and a question for the senator. The suggestion is, first of all, thank you for coming and playing this gig. It's nice for local songwriters to see a well-known touring musician find new ways to do public storytelling. Good for you. For the senator, it's a remark that Dar Williams made in passing as she was reading from her book. She was talking about places that encourage discussions about community, discussions that turn outward or inward depending upon how you position community. The question goes to South End children. I live in an apartment in Burien. By the way, while you're in town, you should visit the Beacon Arts performance space. They drew 600 people last Friday night to a showing of the murals they painted in there. You'll be delighted. The building where I live in Burien, I walk to the back porch, which faces the woods, and I hear kids playing All In Free until 9 at night in Spanish. I walk to the front of my building, and I hear the sirens up on Ambaum Avenue where the cops are pulling down spears, you know, those sirens that say, we own the street, we own the street, we own the street. It strikes me that the children below are living in a bifurcated world. On the one hand, they've got warmth and friends and family behind the building. On the other side, they've got people questioning them for their papers and questioning their right to be here in town, however newly they've arrived. They're growing up with this. Is there any role, do you think, for government or for local agencies to give these children a sense of community that goes into their psychology, that goes into how they're growing up in this bifurcated world they face?
Yes. you're talking about my old neighborhood. So I grew up in Deloridge and went to preschool in White Center. And my preschool was Chicano preschool. And And then I went to school in West Seattle, right by High Point, and then to Kennedy High School in Burien. And so I think that, you know, our school in Graham Hill, which is where my kids are right now, does an amazing job about making sure that our kids feel that comfort. I think that right now, this last week, we know that the national administration came out against making our communities feel that they have support, and trying to end DACA, which is what allows a lot of kids that have grown up in our schools, grown up in our neighborhoods in Burien, and you know, here in South Seattle, to be able to get documents and be able to go to school and have a job and have opportunities. And that is right now being attacked. And in Burien, there is a proposition that that specifically is trying to make immigrant communities feel unsafe and unwelcome, called Proposition 1. And so I am strongly encouraging alumni from Kennedy High School, which is where I went, to come together to say that we are against Proposition 1, and to make sure that a lot of folks that grew up here or in South Seattle are living in Burien, because that's a place that they can afford. And so we have a really vibrant connection between South Seattle and Burien. And so that's one specific thing we can do. The other piece is that I'm working with the legislature down in Olympia to make sure that we put out a call and a what we call a dear colleague letter, basically to our delegation, to make sure that we do everything we can to advance the Dreamers Act, as well as in Washington State, when DACA was moved forward, we passed legislation that makes it easier for students to be able to access our state college grant, our state grants, and to be able to access our community colleges and universities. And so working with legislators to make sure that we protect those rights for families. And I know that Northwest Immigrant Rights Project, One America, and El Centro are three organizations in the last week that have hosted events to make ourselves more aware about what the opportunities and the laws are, so that we can make sure that we're fulfilling our commitment as a community of being a welcoming community. So thank you for that question.
This will be our last question.
Okay. Hi, my name is Kristen. Thank you very much to both of you for being here. And this first part is really to Dar, but my question is actually going to be to Rebecca. So Seattle, as you probably are hearing, is like we're a city of neighborhoods. So there is this, everything you've said about Seattle as a whole, as someone who's lived here for several decades now, that sounds really true to me and resonates. And yet we are also these separate neighborhoods that have done the kind of work that you're talking about, as if we're all small towns, so like Columbia City, Mount Baker, Beacon Hill, like the neighborhoods in this district are doing that work, you know, separately as well as part of Seattle. So this actually leads me to my question to you, Senator Saldaña. What do you started to answer this question actually when I came down here, but it's like what are the things that can be done legislatively in the state, but then also what can you suggest that we as neighborhoods do with respect to the city? What can we ask of the city or demand from the city so that our neighborhoods can, you know, not only enter that tipping point and get past it safely that Dar talked about, but also maintain a healthy balance for our neighborhoods?
Yeah. Well, let's see. I won't take a lot of time. I mean, I'll give a couple ideas in terms of my thinking. I mean, one is that in thinking about this, you know, I think about I do go really local first. So thinking about my neighborhood, I'm part of the neighborhood, I'm Rainier Beach Action Coalition as a neighbor. And so thinking about, we've written a letter, right, to the city of Seattle to make sure that we're getting as much in our zoning of that neighborhood, making sure that we're addressing the growing affordability issue, but also for our neighborhood, we've been really much about how do you make sure that you're growing small business and growing community space. And so looking at how we can actually increase and streamline partnerships with developers that would specifically build towards our vision for ourselves. And then the other piece is, I mean, I think it is thinking about yourself as that bridge builder. Who are the people in your network that aren't working with each other? And so, I mean, again, one concrete action that I'm thinking about taking, and I'm going to say it out loud because maybe it'll make it more concrete, is that between Rainier Beach and Boeing Access, right, we have actually underutilized space. So Sound Transit is the owner there. We have a whole bunch of auto-oriented businesses, and we have a lot of little owned pieces by different property owners. But I do know John Hempelman, who wrote the Growth Management Act. I do know Sabey Corporation that owns the property right there at Boeing Access where there might be a future infill station. I do know Gail Goodwin, whose father was a developer in our community, and they own a couple of parcels there. So as an individual and now as a state senator, how to help convene that conversation about how can we not be thinking about it as just our one property, but if you know we have property, how are we thinking about together creating a collective vision, and then you know, instead of one home here, why couldn't we imagine two homes here or 10 homes here, and how do we build from our collective wealth as renters and homeowners and artists and small business owners that are already here in our communities. So on the policy side, just really quickly, I mean, I do think it is very empowering when you have multi-group, you know, a multi-sector neighbors reaching out to the city and saying, we want growth here, but we want to be part of shaping that growth, and we want to be proactive in that. Of course, on the state level, there's a bunch that we can do. One is that we need to pass the capital budget. So as you may know, there's three budgets. We passed two of them, and we have not passed the third. The third is where so much of the community projects are. So for Washington Care Services, which is an elder Medicaid bed place right around the corner from here, to the Opportunity Center, to the Ethiopian Community Center I spoke of, there's to Mount Baker, there's tons of projects in our district that are being delayed because we have not passed that budget. The second thing, of course, is fully funding the Housing Trust Fund, which has, you know, we made a good investment this year, but we have not completed our investment. And I think the other piece is, you know, looking at how can we address some of the zoning and property taxes that is, you know, I don't agree with the way that we funded our education. I think we can do better. But, you know, working with out-of-the-box thinkers that are realtors, that are in our neighborhoods, that, you know, do want to see a progressive real estate excise tax, they do want to see a progressive capital gains. Like, I think we do actually need those to happen, because the thing about working inside the box is that we need the wonks. And I will say, like, I'm not the wonk, but I know enough about who I need to bring in, and knowing that so many of the folks that are not only shaping our neighborhood, but we have so many people that live in our district that are actually regional players, that are amazing leaders in each of our industries, and we have a wealth of talent in South Seattle and in the 37th. I just want to make sure that we know that, because we actually are the ones that are going to show the way for the city of Seattle and for our state of how we are going to grow well. And it's because of the talent of folks that you represent in the room tonight, but hopefully the people that are watching on the live stream, and the folks that are definitely out playing music right now, which I hope you guys are gonna go there next, because it is that cultivating joy and cultivating connectivity, particularly in these times, is the kind of creativity that I feel like we need. And so those are a couple of the specific things, but a little bit of my ending message.
Yeah, and can I say something as well? Because I just love what you're talking about, and can I just say one more thing? Or okay, because I was thinking about what you were asking, both well, all of you. It says, the strongest towns I have encountered have welcomed the contributions of their citizens. When Beth Macy, author of Factory Man, did a reading at one of my concerts, she concluded by saying, people and communities prosper only when they celebrate a diverse range of equal voices. I want to continue trying to harness the energies of diverse demographics and help add new points of access. I'm not the only one, and I was referring to my town in that one. But, you know, the questions that you're asking show us, and what I hear when I'm listening to the radio here, you know, for the town meetings that are broadcast, things like that, the friends that I have here in Seattle, the ethos is there to say, okay, this is Seattle, how do we create diverse access for diverse voices, diverse equal voices? So the ethos is there, and I actually consider that, you know, this is chicken and the egg thing. You have to have that desire to, and as you say, to push a little on something, to push it farther, to say, yes, we have this identity, but how do we create access? That ethos is here, and I think this is a wonderful sort of symmetry where these questions are the first questions. These are not the questions that they asked in New Jersey. These are not the questions that they asked in Berkeley last night. But to hear these questions coupled with this concern, I think, you know, there is a moment when a respect for planning and a respect for deliberative, local, step-by-step local government comes in. And I believe that the election of people like, well, specifically Rebecca, are indicative of that ethos. You know, you are so careful and caring about how all these pieces are going to fit together so that there is an access of equal, a diversity of equal voices. And I just want to applaud you and all of the people that I know from this city that I've worked with for caring so much about making sure that access is there. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Rebecca Saldaña, Dar Williams. I think this is an auspicious start to our season down here. All the creativity in this room is very inspiring to me. Thank you so much. What I Found in the Thousand Towns is available for sale at the Third Place book table right back there, and Dar will be signing right up here on stage. Thanks again so much for being here. One more round of applause.
Thank you. That was excellent.